Good morning, everyone. We'll go ahead and get started as we get settled in. So happy, I guess, long weekend at this point. Canada Day is a couple of days past, so we'll just say happy long weekend. But I know we got some of our families who are away enjoying the extra time off and the long weekend. So we hope that you guys stay safe around the fire pit or whichever you're going to be doing, camping, chasing bear, whatever you want to do on your free time this weekend. I hope you're enjoying it. So as we get started, we do have what we call our worship guide, which there's a QR code, and I forgot, I had them printed, little cards for every table, had them printed, and I have no clue where I put them in my office. They're buried somewhere, or I accidentally threw them away. I don't know. Next week, we'll have those. But if you, as you walk in, there was a sign that had a QR code, or you can go to our website, and under the worship tab, it says worship guide. But it just has all the stuff you need for today, links, further details, and everything like that. So as we get started, so this Sunday, a little bit of exciting Sunday, because it's our first Sunday that we'll be back in person on a weekly basis. We have been doing first and third, yeah? So we will still be hosting Zoom for those who will be joining us online. And so we're happy to do that. And as you can tell on the screen, there's a couple things. So as far as like kind of the COVID precautions, today is as we have been doing, because even though the restrictions and things lifted for our province, the masking bylaw has not changed officially yet for Calgary. So once that changes, we will adjust as needed. Before today, we are doing mask. Distancing is encouraged, but it's not going to be, you know, mandatory, whatever your comfort level is. We're also going to kind of do away with that 15-minute time limit at the end of the service, just to limit interaction. That will be no more as well. So we're going to just kind of ease. We don't want to, like, you know, shock everybody. The other day, we were at the Dillard's helping them move, and I walk into a house, and there's, like, six people in there. It's like, this is different. Like, I didn't know how to act, and I just walked out and ran away. So anyways, but today also we are starting back our kids class. It's been, what, 18 months? 18 months since we've had a kids class, and so our kids have done an amazing job worshiping in here with us. So they will be dismissed during the worship time and before the sermon, okay? So please, if you haven't already, you can check in now. And parents, whenever we do dismiss, it'll be in between it'll be right after the first worship song. There will be a note on the screen that will tell you they're now dismissed. And we just ask that one parent will walk with the kids down, because we do have to go down the steps to the boardroom where the kids' class meets. We ask that one parent does go just for going down the steps and everything else. And there is a restaurant happening on the other side here, so we don't want, you know, kids roaming into a kitchen and finding a butcher knife. So anyways, kids' class today. And then afterward, parents, as soon as we are done in here, please go down and get your children before you come back and socialize, okay? Please do that so that the volunteers can come up as well. What else am I missing? Oh, if you're new with us, whether in person or online, we do have an online connect card that you can fill out. Just lets us get connected with you a little bit better, send you more details, answer questions you have. So you can click that there on the worship guide as well. And that way we can just get to know you a little bit better this week. And for those of you who are joining on Zoom, you're probably pros at this by now, but we do always recommend that you do the side-by-side speaker view. That way you can see the slides and the speaker at the same time. Stay muted, but at the end, we're still going to do our Zoom hangout, and so we'll invite you to open up your microphone there, turn on your video, and chat a little bit more. So as we keep going, Danielle, you're praying for us, correct? I think so. Danielle, you come up and pray for us. And a few things that we do need to be in prayer for as we continue. Caleb's mom, Dolores, has been battling some issues with the heat. A couple trips to the hospital this week, almost had a heat stroke. Dolores and Jack are out in BC, and they hit 44 last week, I think, or something like that. And so we just want to pray for Dolores today as well. So Danielle, come on up and lead us in prayer.
Okay. All right. Dear God, thank you for everyone gathered today and for your presence here. Please soften our hearts and open our minds to understand what you have to teach us through your word, the Bible. We pray for the children, families, and community affected by the residential schools. The pain is so great that it is only through you that healing can come. Mark 10:27, Jesus looked at them and said, "With man it is impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God." God, I pray for the church. 1 John 2:6, whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. Let us reflect your love, your character at this time when the world needs you. God, please be with our service today. Please speak through Nokomis. And please be with Kaylin's mom. Let her feel so much better really quick. And thank you that you protected her and it wasn't anything more serious. Thank you for today. Amen.
Let's start our worship with a song. And feel free to stand up, and it's okay to sit down as well.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King of
trust in Jesus. The moment I awake, and when my soul is lost at sea, He will be my rock. My vision being Christ alone, this grace is all we've got. His love like the mighty ocean, His love for me will never stop. Oh, His arms are strong enough to carry me through it all by the grace of God. Upon His shoulders, safely brought this far, helper of my helpless soul, the King of broken hearts. His love like the mighty ocean, His love for me will never stop. Oh, His arms are strong enough to carry me through it all by the grace of God. Sing again, His love. His love is like the mighty ocean. Carry me through it all by the Jesus, Lord. We thank you for your grace and love this morning. And we are amazed by what you have done for us, Lord. Your sacrifice. Your laying down of your life, Lord, for us to be saved. Thank you for carrying us so far with your grace this morning, Lord. And as we listen to your word through Nokomis today, teach us and empower us to live according to your word, Lord, and according to your will. Thanks and glory and all of our adoration today. Thank you. In the name of Jesus, I pray.
Matthew chapter 5, verse 33 to 37. Again, you have heard that it was said to our ancestors, you must not break your oath, but you must keep your oaths to the Lord. But I tell you, don't take an oath at all, either by heaven, because it is God's throne, or by the earth, because it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, because it is the city of the great king. Do not swear by your head, because you cannot make a single hair white or black, but let your yes mean yes, and your no mean no. Anything more than this is from the evil man. Amen.
So, good morning, y'all. I want to start off with a bit of a question. Am I the only one that's up here, or am I the only one here that actually reads the or that does not read the terms and conditions when I'm signing up for a like streaming service? Like, you know, with Netflix or maybe Spotify, you know, before you can actually use that streaming service, you have to say that you clicked the box saying that you've read all the terms and conditions. Who actually reads those? Okay, I want to know what those terms and conditions say, because I don't read them. So, but if you're like me and you don't read them, I'm not trying to pressure you into actually reading them. I'm not going to try to pressure you into that, but I do want to talk about something that seems very simple, but yet when you really dig into the reality of it, it can seem quite impossible. And that's tell the truth. So, as we read in Matthew 5, 33 through 37, just to kind of set up a little background here, verse 33 starts with, again, you have heard it, was said to our ancestors, you must not break your oath, but you must keep your oaths to the Lord. What Jesus is referring to is an Old Testament law that ensures honesty in business deals and wedding vows. So much like how we have our own ways of assuring a commitment or having a type of oath, whether that's with a car loan or whether that's with a mortgage on a house, and just like back in that day, we have weddings now, right? What you're saying is that you're making a commitment to another person or to a company, saying, "I'm going to either commit my life to you and to only you, and I'm going to love you forever from till death do us part, or I'm going to pay X amount of dollars on this house over X amount of years to own it for myself," or same thing with the car, right? So what that law was, again, that law was set up to ensure honesty in your communication. But it's not just that. That verse actually, or that law actually implies something a little bit deeper than that. That it's not just having honesty in your important forms of communication, such as oaths or wedding vows, but it's also it's supposed to ensure honesty in our lesser forms of communication, just everyday conversation. So what Jesus essentially does in this law when it comes to verses 33 through 36 is he actually adds on to that. He's not just saying, okay, like you heard this law, keep it. He's saying, not only have you heard this, what I'm telling you to do is don't make an oath at all. Don't swear at all. Because it implies this, that for the citizens of the kingdom of heaven, they ought to be honest at the core of their person. In so much that if a citizen of the kingdom of God says, I will be there to help you, or I will be there to help Kayla move at 10:30. They're going to be there at 10:30. And you can trust that and you can know that. However, what we know with humanity as a whole, we tend to not do that. We fall short of that. So in this text, we're going to go over the two do, the two don'ts and the do that Jesus gives that teaches not only where we fall short, but what we ought to do with that, with knowing that we fall short. The main thing that, however, I do want to just make sure this is known, that the main thing that Jesus wants us to know is that he lived his life embodying integrity and honesty. And we as his people should strive to tell the truth and keep our commitments led and guided by the Holy Spirit. And so, going into the first don't, Jesus says, don't swear at all. That's verse 34. The reason why he says don't swear at all is because, again, we fall short of keeping our own oaths. In the Old Testament, keeping a covenant was a matter of life and death that was established verbally between two parties. Unlike today, they didn't have a piece of paper that said, okay, I'm going to write this down. This is my commitment to you. I'm going to fulfill it. I signed my name, and that is, and my word is kept on this piece of paper. It was through verbal communication. It was orally. So it would be us having a conversation. If I wanted to trade with you or to barter with you, I would say, I'm going to give you X amount of sheep or X amount of crops that signifies that this is worth trading with you. And I would say that and keep that as a covenant. Or if I made a covenant with your family and my family that we would be at peace with one another, we would establish this kind of a covenant. And breaking that covenant would have severe consequences. In short, their words mattered. And for us today, we may not have those type of covenants verbally. And in fact, I'm pretty sure everyone in this room has either said or knows someone that said the words, I promise to you, and verbally, and really hasn't fulfilled that commitment, and nothing happened, right? I mean, maybe you have to have a conversation to discuss, like, what happens after that. You know, you have to try to rebuild that trust, but nothing as bad as what happened in the Old Testament. However, we can look at every single one of our conversations every single day with anybody that we come in contact with as a mini covenant. Because those conversations can do three things. It either establishes, builds, or affirms trust. Therefore, our words matter. So, the beautiful thing about what Jesus is actually saying in this first don't, is that it should teach us that we understand the weight of what it means to make a promise. That we would know that Jesus' statement is not merely a do or don't, because if it was just that, and if it's that simple, then the weight of it is not there. It doesn't really mean much. But it's an act of his own grace that is put in place to protect us from the weight of failing to fulfill that commitment that we made. And ultimately, what Jesus is saying is, to protect our relationships with one another and ultimately with himself. So what this failing to look like, or failing to fulfill a covenant can look like, or failing to fulfill a promise or a breakdown of that communication can look like, is deception, which intentionally misleading someone. I am not a fan of deception. Like, I kind of think of Lion King 2, because that's like the main song in Lion King 2. Every time I think of the word deception, that song just starts playing in my head. I love it. If you haven't seen it, please see it. It's a funny movie. Outright lying, just blatant lying. Another one is manipulation. Trying to twist what is actually going on. If you need help with something, you kind of manipulate the situation to just purposefully mislead someone to doing what you want them to do or believing what you want them to believe. And also overpromising and underdelivering. That's something that can be very well intentioned. Like, you know that you intend to fulfill this promise, but when you really think about it or when you really put it into action, you kind of bit off a lot more than what you could chew. I know I tend to have that kind of I know I struggle with that myself, because I know when I just have the tendency that when someone asks me for help, I want to help. I aim to help. I want to. Like, that's something I want to do. And sometimes that gets me in trouble, because I say yes to like 5 different people, and it's like time to put it all together, and I'm like, whoa, wait a minute. Like, I cannot, and I'm so sorry, you know? But those things can oftentimes lead to a breakdown of trust. And you have to take that much time to rebuild it. On our own, we actually cannot fulfill that. We can't fulfill that for many reasons. If you really think about it, none of us in here has a perfect record of keeping our promises. I know I don't. I can promise you that. I can see. There we go. I can assure you of that. But if you're having trouble thinking about that, I have a couple of things a couple of instances for you to think about. Have you ever promised your kid a reward and forgot to fulfill it because of a work emergency, or something just came up, or the day just got away from you? Have you made a promise to your spouse or family member and failed to follow through? Have any of these things happened to you? And if the answer to at least 2 of those 3 questions is yes, then you know what that means. You know how that feels. You've experienced that. One of the most jarring examples of that for me in my own life is one of the last conversations I had with a friend of mine. We've known each other since the 4th grade, and we grew up together. We went to high school together, and I had just started working at Quiznos in my hometown. And one day he went with a couple of our other friends to go swimming. He called me up and said, "Hey, we're gonna go swimming in about 30 minutes or about an hour or so. Do you want to come with us?" I said, "Of course." Like, you know, of course I'm gonna go. We all love to go swimming. It was a hot summer day. It was kind of like this heat wave with 100% humidity. It was just not fun, so it was a great day to go to the pool, right? But about 30 minutes after that, my boss called me and said, "Hey, somebody didn't come to their shift. Do you want to cover it?" Me being 16 and just wanting like a little bit of extra spending money, I said, "Of course, yeah, cool." I called my friend back and said, "Hey, I can't come. I just got called into work. But we'll hang out tomorrow. I promise." And that was the last conversation I had with him. Because an hour after I got to my job, he drowned. I never thought that that would have been like my last conversation with this friend of mine. And the last words that I said to him were, "I promise." And that's a promise I can't fulfill in this life, you know. And going through that, for a long time I carried like weight from that, but I know Christ has like redeemed me, or redeemed that. And he was a believer, so I know that, you know, I will see him again. But they don't have to be a dire situation like that. It can be the small things. hey, we'll stop by McDonald's on the way home. I have McDonald's money this time. Like, and just drive straight past it and forget. All those things tend to overpromise and underdeliver or failing to fulfill a commitment. So if we can't keep promises for things that we cannot control, right? Situations that come up, we can't control them. So we can't fulfill those promises because of things we can't control. We often try to make promises over things that we think we can control. But to this, Jesus also says, the second don't swear by your head, because you cannot make one hair, a single hair, white or black. Now, the job I work at, Rexall, we have, and you go to Walmart or anywhere else, and you see all these different hair dye solutions. So, now we can make our hair white or black or whatever color we want nowadays, right? But the reality is that that's a facade. That's a facade. We control it. We can make our hair white or black today in a 21st century time, but the reality is hair is not really that color. You know? So we think we can control it, but that in and of itself gives a false sense of control. So we do that with telling the truth sometimes because we want to do things like omitting. So we'll tell the partial truth, but we won't tell the whole thing because, you know, we have to make ourselves look good. Or we want to use this truth as a weapon to make sure that we win an argument because we have to be right. Sometimes we want to ignore it. Sometimes we want to add our own rules to it. One way I can think of that is actually from Genesis 3, when you think about the conversation that Eve had with the serpent. When the serpent actually said, did God say, you cannot touch this fruit lest you die? Eve said, no. God said we can't eat it nor touch it. When God only said, can't touch it. Where Eve was actually doing something out of, I would say, good intention. She was trying to make sure she did what was right. It wasn't exactly what God said. Which kind of shows the importance of following, or the need for us to follow what the Lord says in that sense. Sometimes we even see others see lies in other people, or we see other people lie and we detest it, we hate it. But then we'll give ourselves a little bit of grace when we know we are going to tell a lie. So we do things like that all the time. And I can, and again, like in my own childhood, I can tell you this. I used to lie a lot, okay, about the simplest things. It was bad, okay? My dad would tell me, take the trash. I want the trash out before I get home. Okay, cool. I'll get home from school. I'll watch TV. We had dial-up internet, so it's not like I could have really got on the internet and, like, surfed the web or anything. I wouldn't even do my homework. I would just watch TV, basically. And I hear the car pulling in, and I'm like, oh, no, I got to take the trash out. So I'd run, hurry up and take the trash out. I'd go all the way around the backside of the house so he wouldn't see me taking out the trash. He'll come up like, did you take the trash out? Yes, I did. I did it as soon as I got home from school. Didn't need it. Nope. That's not the case. No, I didn't do that. It would be so pointless. But that's what I did. That was what was in me, right? But see, here's the thing about that. God sees us telling those lies, and no matter where they come from, and the desires, no matter what form they come in, he sees them and desires something better for us. Because God knows the brokenness that dishonesty leads to. The brokenness of our relationships with one another, and ultimately the brokenness of our relationship with him. And so when Jesus gives these statements, it's almost like he wants you to think about, do I match this? Am I able to do this? Can I do this? Have I been doing this? And what he does is make something that seems already hard enough impossible. He does that with this next statement. And this is where you get the do. Let your yes be yes, and your no mean no. In this, Jesus is not saying, basically, be honest. He's not saying, make sure you tell the truth about 85% of the time. You know, that's still, if we're in class, that's a B. So, I mean, that's a good, you did a good job there, right? He's not saying that. He's saying, tell the truth. Tell the truth. And what we do in our own context, if you walk up to anybody, if you ask anybody out there, do you tell the truth? First inclination is to say yes. Have you ever lied? And if they say yes, then it's which statement do you believe? That they tell the truth or that they've told the lie? Which one is it? If they told the lie, then they don't always tell the truth. The thing that Jesus is getting at is not, again, not tell the truth 85% of the time. He's saying tell the truth 100% of the time. And so what he does is he strips away all the ambiguity and the generalizations that make this command so much more impossible in reality than what we assume it to be. Because here's the thing. Telling the truth requires a heart and a mind with a vision fixed on the kingdom of God at its very core, from start to finish. It requires a person so deeply connected with God and so filled with the Holy Spirit that the thought of telling a lie would never even cross their mind. Is that you? I know that's not me, because like I said before, like, I checked the terms and conditions box knowing good and well I did not read it. Have you been doing that? I strive for it, but I know I fall short. And if you're like me, and that answer is no, the simplest way I can say this is that that's actually kind of where Jesus wants you. He wants you to realize this one thing, that we cannot keep that standard on our own. We are unable to. Because you see, the law reveals that we are indeed sinners in need of a Savior. And walking away from just, if I leave it at that, saying that we cannot fulfill this standard on our own, if I leave it at that, that seems disheartening. But the good news is this, that Jesus Christ has fulfilled this requirement in his own life on earth. Through his death, burial, and resurrection, accredited that righteousness to his people. So then, in this text, here's a question. How does this show us who God is? When God spoke in Genesis 3, again, going back to Genesis 3, we talked about the conversation between Eve and the serpent, so we all know how that goes. That conversation happens. Eve eats the fruit. Adam was with her. He eats the fruit. And then God goes on this long slew of just explaining the consequences and the curse that befell the world and mankind because as a result of sin. But as he's talking to the serpent, he speaks to the serpent specifically and says, I will put enmity between your seed and the woman's seed. Already saying that there's going to be a time where this comes to an end. Talking about righting the wrongs of mankind and crushing the head of the serpent while the serpent bruises the heel of the woman's seed. And that as you read through the rest of the Old Testament, you see God following through with that. If you think about a camera lens, if you want to get the bigger picture, you got to zoom out. So Genesis 3, that first mention of the woman's seed crushing the head of the serpent is that wide, bigger picture. But then as the Old Testament continues on, as God continues working through the Old Testament, you see that focus starting to come in. And ultimately in Isaiah 53, Isaiah 7, Isaiah 9, and Isaiah 53 are three of the most pointed passages that point to Jesus. Isaiah 53 talks about the suffering servant that was going to come and bear the iniquity of his people. He was going to bear that iniquity. Psalm 22 is another good one. Jesus literally quotes Psalm 22 when he was on the cross. This shows us who God is because he made a statement in Genesis 3:15, and you see him in the Old Testament following through to it all the way until Jesus' life. And when you see Jesus' life, you see the culmination of everything that God has said about his servant in the Old Testament personified in Jesus. And then you see in his death, burial, and resurrection, victory over sin. And in Revelation, you see the culmination of that. That will be a reality one day that we live in. We will live in a world without sin. We will live in a world where we are at our core will tell the truth. That's not us now, but we are day by day walking towards that. Day by day living towards that. So here's how this actually transforms us. I want you to remember the Beatitudes. When Dustin preached on this at the beginning of the sermon series, the very first Beatitude was Matthew 5:3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. And Dustin talked about how this was the people that could admit that they cannot follow God on their own. They cannot love God on their own. They have a broken relationship with God, that they are in their sin, and they need a Savior. So if we can all admit we are not honest at the very core of our being, if we can all admit that, then we can count as those poor in spirit. We can admit that because we know that we need a Savior to save us from that. We need someone that has been able to fulfill that standard and able to live that out. If you can admit that you have a problem with sin, and if it's not lying like in today's sermon, is it anger? Is it lust? Is it selfishness and pride? If you can admit those things, then God is, like, that is the beginning stages of where God wants you to be. Because the next thing he wants you to do is turn away from that and trust in him. Trust in his work. Trust in his word that he said about Christ himself. Believe in Jesus. That Jesus was telling the truth about who he is. That Jesus is the Son of God who came to this earth, who died on the cross for your sins and mine, and rose on the third day. And in believing that, and knowing that, and acknowledging that, and living that out, God's Spirit indwells us and leads us into this in this new life with opportunities to tell the truth that can be means of sharing the gospel, of sharing the good news of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. We can be liars that have been redeemed by Christ to tell other liars the very truth of the gospel. And so now, how does this apply? What do I do now? Like, you've told me that I'm a liar, I need to believe in Christ. What does that mean? The first thing kind of is based on the last thing that Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. If we have claimed to have surrendered our lives to Christ and yet we still struggle, let your yes mean yes. Those doubts, those struggles, they're real and they're there. I'm not going to take that away. I'm with you on that. We all walk through that struggle. But let your yes to your surrender to Christ be a yes. And follow him. Let that yes be yes. And as you follow Christ, Here's how I have to explain it in this way. There's a book that I've been reading, and I really like this book, okay? And here's what the author is actually paints a pic. The author actually paints a picture of our hearts being a compass and a motor, okay? A compass because just like how we know compasses to work, it points to true north. It points to north so that you always know at least what direction you're facing or where you're going at all times. And a motor propels us to go from point A to point B. We know that because we all drove here in cars. So our heart is like a compass because it aims towards something. It's aiming towards something. In our sin, it's aiming towards our own selfish desires. And it's aiming away, as far away as possible from who God is. But in Christ, as the Spirit is working in our lives, the Spirit aims our heart and reorients our hearts towards Jesus. That way, we follow in his footsteps. We desire to tell the truth. We desire to know who he is. And our heart is a motor that at every day, as we move closer to eternity with Christ, that the Spirit pushes us towards Christ-likeness. In that, we get to live lives of integrity and honest. In that, we get to be honest about our struggles. In that, we get to encourage one another in the midst of our struggles. We get to, despite living in a culture that teaches us to be strong and never let anybody see your weaknesses, we get to actually encourage one another and lift up one another in the face of that. We get to bear one another's burdens. We get to love one another the same way that Christ has loved us. And so with that, I just want to invite you to take some time to reflect. Talk to God right where you're at. About what you've heard and just ask yourself these questions. What has God shown you today? What are you going to do about it and how can we help? So, C-Song, if I can invite you to come and play. In this response, I want you to reflect on who Jesus is, what he's done. Reflect on reflect. Reflect on the death, burial, and resurrection. At your tables, we have communion ready for you. That as you reflect and respond in your own time, just remember the commitment that Jesus gave. That every time we take of the cup of the bread and the cup, that we're joining with him in membership in who he is, in partnership with the God in the gospel. We rely on Christ's work in his death, burial, and resurrection in that. So, Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your word. I pray, Father, that ultimately this was glorifying to you. I just pray that your Spirit is at work in all of our lives, conforming us to the image of your Son, working in our own hearts, in our own minds, to be more honest with one another, with ourselves, with you. We thank you and we love you, and it's in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
take the bread of life, broken for my sin, your body crucified to make me whole again. I will recall the cup poured out in sacrifice to trade this citizen for your new covenant. Hallelujah, I live my life in remembrance. Your promise I won't forget. I walk salvation's road with fear and trembling. Your way born as my own, as Christ is formed in me. Hallelujah, I live my life in remembrance. Hallelujah, your promise I won't forget. To think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. See, you've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. Oh, to think. To think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. One more time, sing it. You've been so, so, you've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. Oh, to think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. As far as heights reach from the depth, as far as east is from the west, so far your grace has carried me. Until I see you face to face, until at last I won my race, remind me you're not finished yet. As far as heights reach, As far as heights reach from the depth, as far as east is from the west, so far your grace has carried me. Until I see you face to face, until I last time won my race, remind me you're not finished yet.
You can have a seat as we just wrap up with a few announcements. Man, Nokomis, we've been joking. So Nokomis, he's a pastoral intern with us, so he's in seminary and will one day be sent out from us to start a new church. And we joke with him that he's like, every time he does something, like he backed the trailer in straight today. So he got to like level 14 as intern level. I think you just jumped to like level 22. You just went up a couple levels. You skipped some good ones there. So, thank you, Nokomis, for leading us in that today. Just as we wrap up today, just a few quick announcements. With the change in our kids club, we're offering a kids class here in person now. And so, for the summer months, our kids team will not be doing the online lessons and videos, and we won't be delivering the craft kits to the doors as we were doing, because kids are getting that here. But we are still providing the Bible lesson and things on the website for those of you who are at home and want to do the same lesson the kids just had. You can download that, go through the Bible story, and have that for your kids as well. And speaking of kids, parents, please make sure that you go and get your kids before you socialize, okay? So as soon as I'm done here, go ahead and go down and then bring them back up so we can all hang out together. Also, just for the summer, we are going to have like a church picnic in August. There are a few Sundays we can't be here at the golf club because they have other events. So we've added, created an event calendar that we are sharing. If you go to the bottom of the worship guide, it's right there at the bottom as well. Or you can download it, add it to your own calendar, view it anytime. We just thought it'd be a simple way that you can just look on your own calendar and see what's happening at Hope Church with different events and worship services. All through July we'll be here, but in August there'll be a little bit of back and forth just because of scheduling. So that'd be a great way for you to view that as well. Also today, since we are kind of celebrating starting back weekly in-person services, it is a holiday weekend, we have cupcakes in the back. We can now share food, and I have been excited ever since I bought these cupcakes this morning. So we weren't able to really share food and all that, but today we can legally. I can say it on camera. We don't have to hide things. Oh, I'm just kidding. We weren't doing that. one time that happened, and I just had to delete that on the video. That's another story. Anyways, but feel free to grab a cupcake in the back there. You can stay in here and eat them as we hang out and chat. For those of you who are joining on Zoom, I'm sorry you won't get cupcakes here. But if you want to come by my house, if you know where I live, you can grab a cupcake, because I bought 48, and so we should have at least two left over. You can fight over those on my front porch. So, let's read our closing verse as we wrap up today, and then parents, you can go get your kids, and we can hang out for a little bit. It comes from Romans 15:13. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you believe, so you may be filled with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So thank you for worshiping with us today. Have a great rest of your weekend. Enjoy this cool weather before the next heat wave comes. God bless. Take care. Grab a cupcake.